Okay, so good afternoon. Aaron, in his talk, mentioned user-centered design, and someone afterwards asked what user-centered strategies were. I'm hoping that in the next half an hour, I'm going to answer exactly that question. So if anybody's left with that question at the end, I failed miserably, and I should be on the first plane home. I'm going to talk about human-centered design and how human-centered design gives us an alternative approach to library strategy, how that relates to the ethnographic practices that Andrew's talked about, and also share some experiences from Cambridge University and our work there. So let me start, though, by just introducing myself, because my background's a little bit different maybe to most people in the room. I'm a product and service designer. I'm principal designer at a design practice and innovation consultancy called Modern Human. And I've been doing that for about 15 years. So I've designed all sorts of things, from dashboards for driverless cars to connected home appliances, retail stores, the lot. I've done all sorts of different things. I've also been head of innovation at Cambridge University. And at the moment, my design practice is working with Cambridge on a program called FutureLib, looking at the future of academic libraries there. We, as a practice, we specialize in imagining disruptive new products, services, and experiences and turning them into reality. And I want to talk about a little bit today about how we do that, because I think it might be interesting about how you might apply some of these methods that are perhaps used for dashboards for driverless cars or smart home appliances to what's happening in your libraries. As designers, we get invited into big organizations to help them create new products, or startups come to us with ideas and want us to turn them into credible new products in the marketplace. As consultants, we kind of go in and we help embed design thinking into organizations. And so, I'm certainly not an expert in libraries. I could never call myself that. But what I get to see is lots of different kind of situations and lots of different circumstances and design lots of different things, which means that my head's full of all of these examples that I can pull from and kind of mash up, you know, something that happens in retail with a cool technology I've seen somewhere else and kind of collide them together. And that kind of perspective is sometimes useful. So I'm hoping to share some of that with you today. But I want to start with a definition of design, because as soon as I mention design, you've probably got a preconceived idea of what I'm talking about. And some of you will think I'm talking about the beautiful pencil-thin visual profile of this iPad. Some of you will think about the curves of an Italian car. Some of you might think about the typefaces you use on your own websites. You know, everybody's kind of got this kind of opinion about what design might be. But actually, all of those things I've mentioned are really only the tip of the iceberg, the visual appearance of a product. And actually, it takes 1,000 different ideas to turn a product or service into reality. And at every stage, you know, we as designers, we have kind of this method for thinking in structures. And so just below the waterline of that iceberg, we think about information. What information is this product or service going to give people? In what order? What status is it going to report about its situation? How is it going to help people? We think about interaction. How are people going to use this thing? How are people going to sign into it? How are people going to find the buttons that they need to click and press to make it work? And those things happen within a detailed design process. So right where we're thinking alongside where we're trying to create beautiful curves and thinking about the typefaces we're going to use and all of those kind of things, we're also thinking about information and interaction. But way before that, way before we get to that kind of stage, we think about structure. So the iPod, does anybody remember the Zune? The Microsoft Zune, it was an MP3 player. They were awfully popular as I remember, right? They were a competitor to the iPod. The iPod absolutely wiped the floor with them, because what the iPod had is it had iTunes. It had this ecosystem of a thing that sat on your computer which made it easy to put tunes onto your iPod. Now, somebody thought about that. Somebody thought about that. Unlike Microsoft, who didn't think about that, who made it your problem. Okay? And so this thing about structure is exactly that. How do the parts of a product or service relate in order to create a joined-up experience? And I've seen libraries really fall down at that. You know, they have a discovery system, they have a thing over here, they have a service over there, they have a help desk over there, but nothing that links those things together into a holistic experience. And so that's where design helps in those kind of situations. Below that even, we think about concept. So the concept is all about how you might deliver value to a user. And those two areas are what we call conceptual design. So what is this thing? What is the shape of this thing? What does it look like? And then right at the bottom, we've got proposition. So designers spend an awful long time, before they do any of the other stuff, thinking about what is this thing going to do? What value is it going to deliver? And that's where design strategy comes in. I like to think of, when I think about kind of design and how you kind of tell what a good design looks like, I think it's about understanding, it's about this model. So it's not rocket science to make a product understandable, interesting, and useful. And library services have to be understandable, interesting, and useful in order to make the kind of basic kind of grade. But actually, the pinnacle, like really great services, really great products are indispensable. And I like to think, when I think about indispensable products, I think about Spotify. Are you familiar with Spotify? It's a music streaming service. You pay one subscription and you can listen to anything that they've got on the service. There are other competing services as well. But the thing I like about Spotify is it fundamentally changes my behavior as a music consumer. Because when I had those shiny discs that I had to buy from a record store, CDs, I would buy things that I knew I liked. Because if I didn't like it when I got it home, there was a penalty to that. I'd spent $10 or whatever it is buying a CD that I then didn't listen to. Whereas the risk on Spotify is reduced to zero. So it changes fundamentally how I listen to music. I can be listening to some kind of jazz 1 minute and then switch to Japanese lullapop the next, and I can get all of that. And if I don't like something, I can choose something else. And so I listen more widely. It makes me a more interesting music listener. And I like that. I like how that makes me feel. And that becomes indispensable. And I'm quite happy to pay the £9 a month subscription service on Spotify because it's making me feel better about myself. And that is the pinnacle of design, right? And I think we've got an opportunity in libraries to create those kind of services. Those kind of services who make our students and our researchers better at what they do. So let's have a look how we might do that. So Bill Burnett, who is the executive director of D School at Stanford, he said, to imagine a future that doesn't exist, you really have to understand what people are doing today and completely reimagine it. So much of my time is spent designing things that people don't have now. I can't watch how people use things that they don't have yet. But what I can do is I can watch what they do at the moment. So if I'm designing the dashboard for a driverless car, I can sit and watch how people drive because their behavior extrapolates. And so this is where the ethnography practices that Andrew talked about kind of fit with user-centered design. Let me tell you a story to illustrate this. So does anybody recognize this product? Right? Okay, so do you know the story about how it was designed? This is an OXO Good Grips measuring jug. And there's a single innovation in this jug, and that's that the measure is diagonally inside. Let me tell you the story about how they arrived at that. So they were watching people cook in a test kitchen one day. And they get in, they give people ingredients, they're watching what they're doing. And as these people, they ask them to bake a cake. Does anybody here bake? Right. So those of you who bake know that cooking is an art. But baking is a science. Those measurements are very, very important. They get 5 minutes into this session where they're watching people bake, and they notice people doing this. And it starts in one corner of the room, and it goes all the way across the room. This isn't an isolated phenomena. A scientist would say they're trying to eliminate parallax error when they're baking. Do you know how many focus groups or surveys you would have to send out before anybody wrote on a survey, I need to eliminate parallax error when I'm baking? That's the power of the ethnographic approach when it comes to design, right? Because they saw this happening, and as Andrew said, it's a hypothesis. Their hypothesis was, well, what would happen if we allowed people to measure liquids from a standing position rather than from a jigging about position? Right? And so they invented this. What would happen is people would pay about twice the price of a normal measuring jug in order to not have to do that silly bobbing motion. We've seen a similar thing at Cambridge where we looked at how people were using resources and we watched users take photographs of reference copies. They got their mobile phones out of their pocket and they took photographs of 30 or 40 pages of reference copies. Now, they could have sat in the library and used that reference copy. They could have probably negotiated all of those weird systems to get an electronic resource, but they didn't. But the particular students we were watching, they wanted to go and study, this student wanted to go and study in their room because they found it easier to concentrate on writing an essay when they could sit with a cup of tea, maybe a bacon sandwich, and sit typing. You can't do that in libraries at Cambridge. And so what they were doing is they were taking these 30 or 40 pictures, putting them in a PDF, and then leaving the library with what they needed. Can you imagine what they were doing when they got back to their room to go through all of those pictures? And so what we see is from observing people, we understand what they do, and we also understand why they're doing that. And so then what we can say is, well, what kind of design interventions could we make to make that person's life easier? Because what they've done is they're not particularly tech savvy. They've just took the device that they have in their hand, in their pocket every day, and used it to try and solve a problem. Can we create a better solution? Can we remove the friction out of that experience? So human-centered design is informed by design research, and design research uses ethnographic techniques. Every design practice will have its own kind of slide about what the design process looks like. This is ours. We think of design as being four overlapping spaces. The first one's the immerse phase, right? So that's where we go in, we understand what people are doing, how they're behaving, what their values are, what their needs are. Sometimes people are not very good at articulating their needs. Just like nobody in that test kitchen that day would have said, I need to eliminate parallax error when I'm baking. Sometimes people are not very good at vocalizing what they really need, because we don't walk around in a state of, what do I need? What do I need? What would make this situation better for me? Actually, we just get on and we do it. And we take our mobile phone out of our pocket and we photograph 30 or 40 pages of a reference copy because that's what we've got available to us. And so the immersion helps us to observe those situations and helps us to kind of understand people's behavior, understand what people's latent needs are. The inspire phase is then looking at how that relates to problems. So you gather when you go out and watch people, you see them do all kinds of weird stuff. And you kind of see all kinds of situations. And so the inspire phase is about sense making. It's about turning that into something that kind of makes sense out of it. Because people, there's a misconception that inspiration arrives in a flash, that you didn't know something and then all of a sudden you did. But actually, it's about filling your head full of stuff systematically so that you can have that flash of inspiration. And so it's valuable to think of it as a process. The imagine phase then is about generating, testing ideas, turning those into kind of prototypes. And then there's the invention phase, where you take an idea and you actually put it in the hands of a user. And that kind of process that goes from a project stage into a finished product or service in somebody's life. And so that process can be used to design a single product or a single service or a single experience. But it can also be used strategically to think about a set of products or a set of services that work together. And I think that's what the library service is made up of. It's made up of a set of interconnecting spaces and services and products that all kind of need to be choreographed so that they work together. And so you can take that same process that works at the level of an individual product, and you can use it to also define library strategy and create an experience that goes across services and products. And so from the ethnography or the ethnographic approaches of observing people, you then start looking for kind of commonalities. And these are two models from our work at Cambridge. So the first, the student triangle. And what we asked students to do is to keep a diary. And we tracked them using RunKeeper. And we got them to sign up and kind of follow, so that we could essentially follow them without having to follow them. We noticed, so I don't know how much you know about Cambridge, but it's a collegiate university. It has 31 independent colleges where students live. And it has six schools and about 80-odd departments, I think, where they're taught. But there can be 3 or 4 miles between where you live and where you're taught. And so what we noticed is obviously that people do, alternatively, you could actually live next door. So, you know, if you're studying theology and you're at Selwyn College, you can probably roll out of bed at 8:50 and be in a 9 o'clock lecture and you're fine. If you're studying engineering at Girton, then you've probably got to spend 45 minutes on your bike pedaling across the city through heavy traffic. And so there's quite a variety of experiences. And so when we looked at that, we noticed that people existed in this triangle made up of maybe predictably their college and their department as the first 2 points. But the third point was where they like to shop for groceries. That created their whole perception of distance within the city. Because if you were geographically, you know, if your college and department were geographically close, then everything felt further away than those two things, you know, particularly if you were shopping at a handy supermarket. Whereas if you were at a college and a department that were spread out, and then you had a supermarket in the middle, then that created a much broader triangle. And so that, again, tells us where we can cite services, where we can kind of think about putting things, and how people's kind of perception of how inconvenient or convenient things might be differs based upon three kind of factors. The second model is, we created two of these models, one for teaching and one for research. And the second model on the slide is, I don't know whether this is academia in general, but people, or whether it was just Cambridge, but people tell us that their needs are very particular to their discipline. Every discipline is very different and has very, very unique needs. Which is interesting, but kind of tricky when you're trying to design services for all of them. So what I wanted to try and understand was how different, why different, and what the differences were. And so from shadowing academics, we spent days kind of following academics around, and we understood how they were doing research and understood their attitudes and their kind of what we call discipline cultures. And what we saw actually was that people's research cultures could be kind of narrowed down to six factors on this hexagon here. And it was all wrapped up in how they went about their research. And so what we could then say is, we could then tell that, for example, mathematics is closer to modern languages in culture than maybe it is to biology. We could tell that physics and biology, when it came to attitudes about publication and open access, were kind of poles apart. And so then what we could start doing is we could start grouping disciplines together and saying, actually, these disciplines are similar to those disciplines, and so they have similar needs or similar kind of attitudes or similar cultures within them. And so you start with those models, and those models get you thinking. They get you thinking about the problems that the organization has, or the challenges, or the things that it's trying to do, and how you might then bring products and services into the lives of a user. And actually, a lot of organizations are really bad at generating ideas, because the first problem that we see is that people look for ideas for solutions. So they look for ideas of the same size, that actually, you know, that they're looking for one idea that solves everything. And then they're surprised when that's really, really hard. The other thing that we do is we see people kind of brainstorming, and they come up with one work, they get to the first workable idea, and you see the visible relief in the room. Right, we found one, we can all kick off and go back to our desks and do something that we feel more comfortable doing, like a spreadsheet. And so you see that problem as well, that actually people accept the first workable solution that they come up with, and so they never force ideas to compete. When we generate ideas, we know that ideas are going to be different shapes and different sizes. That actually we might have seen a cool technology over here. You know, that actually we might have seen a cool interaction model over there. We might have seen something that doesn't work and puts people off contributing to Wikipedia, for example, over here, and we wouldn't want to replicate that. And we know that there are all of these things. And when you look at them, they're all different. They're all kind of different shapes and sizes, and they don't necessarily play nicely together. But actually, then what you do is you start forming them together. That's where a concept comes in. So a concept is a set of ideas that kind of start coalescing together. It's a clearly articulated central idea around which the features and benefits of a product or service combine. That's a pithy little phrase to kind of explain it, but it's actually better to give you an example. So one of the things we observed at Cambridge is that there was an abundance of places that people could work. You know, the city's got countless cafes. The university's got 114 libraries. And so there was a countless kind of spread of places that people could work. And still, students preferred to work in their rooms. And so partly because this abundance of spaces was hidden from them. And so we kind of got TripAdvisor in our minds a little bit. We knew that location services meant that we could locate the user. You know, we'd seen kind of lots of faceted search on holiday sites. And we start colliding these ideas together, and we come up with Space Finder. And all Space Finder is it's a search service that enables users to find different types of spaces in which to work and study across the university. So you power this thing up. It knows where you are because it's on your mobile phone. And it says, hey, these are the spaces around you. If it doesn't know where you are, you can access it on a desktop computer as well. And if it doesn't know where you are, you can search. And you can say, hey, I'm looking for somewhere really quiet. I'm looking for somewhere where I can drink a cup of tea at the same time as working. And it will kind of narrow those things down to you. So that's kind of one service that we came up with. And you can see there, there are about 15 or 20 ideas that go into Space Finder of all different shapes and sizes, but they all coalesce around this idea of Space Finder, this concept. App Store, we watched academics in working, and what we noticed, we noticed a particularly pronounced example where one of our academics was studying ancient manuscripts. And he'd used library equipment, and he'd taken very, very detailed photographs of these ancient manuscripts so that he could study them later. When he'd got these photos, he'd downloaded them to his computer, and then he'd put them in a Word document. So every time he wanted to find one of those photos, he would go zooming up and down this Word document. And of course, then Word had handily for him resized them to the width of an A4 sheet of paper. Because that's the perfect width for a photograph of an ancient manuscript. We felt even worse for him when we noticed he was working on a Mac. A Mac comes with a free piece of software called iPhoto. I don't know how many people know it, but essentially iPhoto's whole purpose is to catalog photographs. It allows you to tag them, it recognizes the people in them, it knows where the photographs were taken, knows what camera they were taken with, all sorts of things like that. And so this academic had got the perfect piece of software, probably already on his machine, to do this job. Probably, and it's free, didn't have to pay for it, and he'd used what he knew, which we all have a tendency to do, and that was Microsoft Word. And so we said, well, and we noticed this in countless other examples, not quite as pronounced as this poor academic. And so we said, well, how do we get the knowledge of, ideally, we'd want a consultant to sit there and kind of listen to what people are going to research, what they're going to do, and tell them what software they could use. That doesn't scale very well. So what other kind of models are there out there? And of course, there's the Apple App Store. But the problem is that's full of reviews from people who aren't academics. So they don't tell you how to use Evernote for your academic research, or iPhoto's perfect for storing photographs of ancient manuscripts. But it could, if we created an app store. And so this concept came about of an app store curated collection of software tools and apps specifically to academic and student use. It's a simple kind of concept. It's got a bunch of ideas that kind of coalesce around that simple concept. And so if ideas build into concepts, concepts build into visions. And so what we do is from these kind of discrete products and services, future products and services, you then create a vision that says, actually, and what a vision is it's a collection of concepts which, with a set of design principles that describe the experience that you're going to give to a set of users. So it describes the student experience of a library or an academic experience of a library. And the concepts are what kind of flows through that. And so ideas add up to a concept, and concepts add up to a vision. And you can then test that vision. You know, the human-centered design approach is to continually be taking things back to users and testing them, and I'll talk about that in a second. How am I doing for time?
6 minutes.
I'll skip over that one then. So an experience, so if you get to your vision, then the next step from there is to work out how you get to strategy. And so we create these things called experience strategies. So you've got your vision, you know what you're going to create, you can paint a picture of what you're going to create, and then you need a plan with it to say how. What new products and services am I going to create? How am I going to create them? What process am I going to follow to get there? Who am I going to need to do that? What budgets am I going to need to do that? What new skills will my staff need in order to support these services? What new skills will my staff need in order to create these services? And so you start with an idea, and you work bottom up. So traditional strategy approaches start with the organization's mission, and they work top down. And that's how you end up with services that are done to people. Whereas human-centered design flips the whole equation round. And what you do is you work from the bottom up. You work from what people need, the problems that they have, and work back up to your strategy. And you say, this is how we'll achieve it. Not how we'll solve the problem of this particular user down here, but how we solve the problems that people have in research and learning and teaching. And so from that strategy, I want to kind of focus back in a little bit and go back to my design roots a little and say, even a strategy is really only a hypothesis. These are the things that we think will solve the problem. But there's a law of unintended consequences in design. There's a nice example from the UK government decided that they wanted to stop parents taking their children on holiday during term time. And so they decided that they were going to fine a parent £100 if they took their child out of school in order to take them on holiday during term time. Can you imagine what happened? The number of parents taking their children out of school during term time rockets, because suddenly it's £100 to take my child out of school during term time, but I might have to pay double the price of my holiday if I go on holiday during school holidays. They've created a market. And so, with any design intervention that you make, you know there are going to be unintended consequences. Your design is a hypothesis, and so you want to build prototypes. You want to start small and work out. You want to pilot. And so there are various models that you can use around prototypes. So this is one set of prototypes. And what this says is you've got role prototypes which test the role of the product or service in a user's life. You've got look and feel prototypes, which test kind of how it might work, how somebody might drive it. You've got technological prototypes that test whether you can deliver it using the technology. And then in the middle, you've got integration prototypes, which bring all of that together. So when we were developing Spacefinder, our first prototype was literally hand-drawn sketches. We got a Sharpie marker. We got some paper. We sketched out how this thing might work. Then we took photographs of it on our mobile phones, and we stitched them together so that it felt like a mobile interface. And we got people to tap through it. We got people to tell us what they'd look for. We got people to tell us how they'd search for spaces and the dimensions that they would use to search for them. And then we refined that. And we took it up a level of fidelity. So we create blueprints, wireframes of the Spacefinder service. And again, scan them in, put them on a mobile phone, see how people use them. So all of the time, kind of getting closer and closer to the real experience. And at the moment, what we're doing is we're piloting it. So we've released it to the whole student body. They're using it. We're watching what they're doing with it. And at the end of the pilot, we'll then iterate again. Because we think it's kind of a cool solution, but that doesn't count for anything. Will people use it? Will they get value out of it? And so we get both a qualitative aspect. We'll go and talk to them about it. But we also get a quantitative aspect because we can hook it up to Google Analytics and see what they're actually doing with it. That's another model of prototypes. It's probably worth looking at when you get the slides after the session. It's essentially looking at kind of from rapid prototyping, live prototyping, and the different types of prototypes that you could use for different situations. But I kind of want to just finish by reiterating that the same four modes of design thinking, design a product like this, a single product like this, beautiful as it is, but you can also apply the same model, the same kind of process to choreograph whole user experiences and think about the experience that people have, including the space that they exist in, including the services that they use when they're there, human services as well as digital services. And likewise, you can prototype physical spaces. You know, you can set up kind of prototypes where you put people through kind of physical environments that are made out of cardboard boxes and things like that to see how they work and how they move through the space. We do that a lot in retail store design. So you can kind of scale this approach from single product up to entire library experience. So that's me. Contact details at the end.